When talking about electric vehicle fires, I often see statistics in the comments that are linked to this right here. But what if I told you that data was wrong? Even if it was right, it doesn't really matter. Before talking about frequency versus severity, I want to talk about this data set because this data set has been floating around for a very long time. The earliest I could find this was back in 2018, and this exact picture has been in my presentation for years. But ultimately, we don't have the data. We have no mechanism in the US to collect this type of data, and we won't for a couple of years. 2026, it's getting into the details, but that's when we get our new fire reporting system. It's called NERIS. So we start tracking the data. It's going to take a couple of years before we understand the true frequency of electric vehicle fires. And it's frustrating because if you go to the Auto Insurance Easy website, it says updated numbers, 2024, all the same information, and all that information is wrong. But even if it was right, we need to talk about this idea of frequency versus severity. And I'll talk about it from two different angles. First, on the engineering side, because both engineering and firefighting look at this idea of frequency versus severity in a very similar way. On the engineering side, we do something called an FMEA, failure modes and effects analysis, where we're basically looking at different criteria to understand how things can fail. I'll be honest, it's a daunting task that involves a terrible spreadsheet. And as we list out all these failure modes, we have to understand the severity, how often it's going to happen, the frequency, and then is it possible to detect that failure mode? And we give each scenario a rating. If we have a failure mode that's super severe, we're talking loss of life, but it rarely happens, and we can detect when that's going to happen and give some type of warning, the rating's pretty low. On the other hand, if we've got something that when it fails, it's not that severe, but it's going to happen all the time and we can't detect it, it's going to be a high rating. So things have to balance out and we're really looking for those low ratings. When it comes to electric vehicle fires, the severity of some of these fires, it's pretty significant, way more significant than a gasoline-powered vehicle. But even if the frequency is low, because the severity is so high and the fact that we can't detect it, that makes that rating high, it makes it a very unfavorable situation. Think about your home, where you live currently. Do you have fire alarms? I really hope the answer is yes. The odds of you having a fire in your home are relatively low. In fact, most people will never have a fire in their house. But every single house should have fire alarms. That's because once you put that detection aspect in, it could potentially save your life. It reduces the risk, even if there is a low frequency. Because when you look at a fire in your home, the frequency is low. The severity is high. You could have a loss of life, but now you throw that detection method in there. You can detect the fire, warn the occupants. That reduces the overall risk. Detection is one way to reduce the overall risk, but sometimes you're able to reduce severity. Think about this. You've got a bunch of electric vehicles charging at charging stations. They're in a parking lot, and they're basically parked mirror to mirror, no space in between. If one of those vehicles were to catch on fire, you're going to have a fire that's going to extend from vehicle to vehicle to vehicle. There's a couple ways you can reduce the risk there, reduce the severity. Now, you could spread the vehicles out, but we all know that real estate is valuable. The other option is look at EV safety products. They have a proprietary fire barrier that can go between electric vehicles when they're charging in a parking lot. And that will reduce the overall risk because now if you do have a fire in one vehicle, it won't have that spread. Their barrier is patent pending and tested to NFPA standards in a third-party lab. Now on the firefighting side, we also look at risk versus frequency. It's critical for us because we go to a lot of high-risk events. But if it's a high-risk event, and it's a high-frequency event as well, it's something that we go to all the time, those are situations where we thrive. Sure, it's easy to get complacent, but for those high-risk, high-frequency events, we should be training in those areas, and it's something we should be very good at. When we look at those low-risk, high-frequency events, like a fire alarm, not really a big deal. But then when we get on the other side of things, we have low frequency events that are high risk. That's where things can go wrong. Recently, there's a great example of this type of situation. There was a truck that was driving down a bridge. This large truck ended up going off the bridge, hanging down over the water. Terrible situation. Yet, I bet they've trained on rope rescue operations throughout their career. This is not an easy incident to deal with. This takes lots of preparation, and the rescue for this incident took over an hour. This is the definition of high-risk, low-frequency events. And am I saying electric vehicles are high-risk, low-frequency events? I really don't know because we don't have the data right now. But some of the things I'm seeing, especially with the deflagration hazard, that puts a high risk into the incident. That's something if firefighters aren't prepared for, if they don't know it's a possibility, it's going to kill somebody eventually. And it's amazing up to this point that we have not had a fatality related to these types of events. When I talk about electric vehicle fires, when I'm putting information out there about battery energy storage systems, it's to get the information out there. So the first responders understand the risk. They've seen an incident like this before they get it in their own first due.